Welcome to Healing Generations, a podcast creating a dialogue uplifting the importance of healing, strengthening, and supporting our communities, and that addresses the disparities and inequities in communities of color. Healing Generations is brought to you by the Healing Generations Institute, a collaborative initiative of the National Compadres Network and the Brotherhood of Elders. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on our new releases.
Well, welcome. Welcome to Healing Generations. And this podcast is sponsored by the National Comadres Network as we host our once a month podcast. And so as the National Comadres Network, we are so grateful to be able to spend time with you on a monthly basis and talk about issues and just share things that pertain to mujeres. And so as we gather here today and just very grateful for another day of breath and life to Creator, we're excited because we're going to have another podcast with another amazing person to share as we meet our hearts and as we have a beautiful conversation just about life and life's journey and healing and culture. And so it's we're excited that you're joining us today, and thank you because you are picking this time, this hour to spend with us. And I know that it's around the world, and so thank you so much for coming and spending this time with us. Maestra Susie, how are you doing today?
Very good, comadre. Just feeling so much gratitude today with our special guests that we'll be interviewing. I've had that wonderful opportunity of you, Maestra Deb, telling me so much about this special mujer and how powerful she is. So I'm really looking forward to this conversation and this plática today. And I really want to thank our guests for, aside from everything else that you do, that you would be so willing to spend this time with us today and share your medicina, share your experience, your wisdom, and your corazón with all of us. So looking forward to it.
Thank you so much. It's really a privilege to be here with such powerful women and just to be connecting with people around these important topics and, you know, just feeling the love and the power of communion with other women, other Latinos and indigenous people throughout the world.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And, you know, like I say, when we're on these podcasts, you know, with the intention that these words will bring healing and clarity into everyone's lives that are listening, we have such a privilege and an honor, Maestra Susie and I, to be able to interact with these wonderful mujeres that are so defined in their right. And so, without further ado, we're going to jump onto this podcast and. Maestra, you want to give a little history and conocimiento of our guest today?
Absolutely. Let's go forward. Very honored to have our special guest, Dr. Annette Goldman Mosqueda. She is a bilingual bicultural psychologist with over 30 years of experience and achievement in the fields of mental health, substance abuse, and HIV/AIDS program development, treatment, and capacity building. Dr. Goldman Mosqueda has developed and implemented empirically based curriculums for health promotion and community wellness throughout the United States, Europe, and Latin America. She has been a featured guest and speaker in a variety of international venues, ranging from community forums to hospitals and prestigious universities. Among many other things, whether organizing homeless Latinos on the streets of San Francisco, working in the state's maximum prisons, managing mental health services in war zones of Central America, educating Russian immigrants in Europe, or providing clinical direction in a large mental health agency. She approaches each project with humanity and dedication, and of course, con mucho amor. I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Annette Goldman Mosqueda, and maybe you could share a little bit about yourself with us, among all the things that you do, your background, your familia, and maybe a little bit about, you know, how you got to this point in your life, where you're at and what you're doing.
Wow. Okay. it's kind of hard to figure out where to start. I guess I grew up in Puerto Rico until I was 11, came to the United States, and pretty much, you know, kind of grew up in a very unusual circumstance. It's kind of hard to talk about, you know, who I come from, because I don't know a lot about who I come from. I was abandoned by my mother when I was 2 years old in a house with my sister, who was five at the time and had lots of intellectual difficulties. You know, and we ended up staying with neighbors, staying, being split up, staying in foster care. I basically grew up in the system. And, you know, I feel like I'm kind of have come full circle, and I'm back in the system working and supporting people who kind of came from where I came from. You know, it was, I feel like all of my experiences that were challenges, and Deborah and I have talked about this a lot, is like, we look at it in the field of psychology and in community mental health as risk factors. And we tend to focus on things that we call risk factors and not really, I almost, you know, when I was driving over here today, I was thinking about, okay, I always think of things in a visual way. And so the vision that I got was kind of like iron, that, you know, iron is forged through fire. And I feel like, you know, for myself and just for our people in general, that in a lot of ways we're like phoenixes. We, you know, have been through a lot of things, immigration, you know, the justice system, foster care, just, you know, this system that tries to beat us down. And every fight and struggle that we go through makes us stronger and makes us more powerful. And so I feel like while I don't know the specific ancestors that came before me, I feel like, you know, there's this magical connection that we have with each other, with our culture, with our past, with the people that we don't even know that give us strength and wisdom and magic and health and spirituality, and that forges us and makes us into who we are. And, you know, I think that we're kind of born with, we're born to find out what our task is here in Earth. And, you know, and so I feel like I found that in the work that I do. And so, you know, Deborah knows that I really have a hard time speaking in public. I don't like speaking. But somehow I feel like those powers and those legacies kind of converge when I'm speaking, and they flow through me when I'm meeting, whether I'm meeting with a patient or a homeless person, or I'm dealing with people in, you know, struggle and the war zones and who are being shot at. It's, you know, that magical, valuable legacy that we carry within ourselves, it just kind of comes out and flows. It doesn't come from me. It comes from somewhere else. You know, whether we call it God or we call it spirit or we call it, you know, whatever the name that we give it, you know, Buddha or, you know, Allah or whatever, it's all there, and we all have an opportunity to access it and use it for, you know, for good.
Yes, yes. And let me just share that with our audience. We are pulling teeth today because the doc does not like to speak in public. And so when I invited her, she's like, ah, but I hate to do that. And I said, please, you know, please do that. Because her story and her message and her words, I really feel we need to hear. And as mujeres, you know, I know that there's some of us out there listening going, ah, I feel like the doc too. I hate to speak in public, but your words are so important, and the messages that you have in your medicina, you know, is important to share. But doc, I want you to go back a little bit. And I know that you have a trajectory of a lot of work, a lot of work. And so can you share a little bit of that journey? You know, how you began in this field. How did you end up being a psychologist? Where did you start? And how was that beginning? And what was some of that journey like for you that brought you to what you're doing today and the accomplishments in your field, you know, that you have done?
It's kind of hard to pinpoint when that intersection happened. I think that as a child, I was always the person that kind of, you know, we would be in these bad situations, you know, there was domestic violence and there was, you know, just really scarcity of everything, you know, just food and, you know, school and just, it wasn't a good situation. And I feel like for some reason, even though I was not the oldest, I, you know, was raised up in collective environments and group homes and different situations. And for some reason, the kids would always come to me and, you know, as kind of a refuge. And they would ask me, you know, what to do about, you know, a situation, or, you know, I would see something and I would kind of step in and try to deflect the attention to another something else. And so I feel like it kind of came about, it was probably that seed was planted very young and probably before I was even born. And, you know, I think the one incident that kind of comes to mind where this light bulb went off and I said, okay, this seems like this is what I'm supposed to do, even though I just, you know, I have a hard time speaking and putting myself out there. I remember that I had, you know, I left home when I ended up, it's a long story, but I kind of ended up living with my grandfather, who's a Russian Jew. And my grandmother, my step-grandmother, who is from Nicaragua. And I remember when I left home, when I left from there, it was a very tumultuous environment with mental health issues and immigration issues and domestic violence. And I left when I was 15. And I got together with this man. It was a really bad situation. He was using and he was violent. And I left and went to a shelter in San Francisco. And for some reason, even though I was one of the youngest people there, it was a shelter for women and children. Again, these women would come to me and they would ask me for advice, even though some of them were like double my age. And I just kind of fell into this role of helping them navigate the system, helping them navigate, you know, the program that we were in. And they encouraged me to go to school because they thought that I had something that needed to be, you know, fed and nurtured and that I could do something important. And so I went to a community college when I got out of the shelter. And there was this Puerto Rican psychologist there. And he kept pushing me. It was like Deborah. He would push me to get out there and talk to people. And he wanted me to run for student government, which was really a bad experience. Didn't work out. But he also hooked me up with the welfare system. They were looking for somebody to help women who were fleeing domestic violence to navigate the system and to get into school. And I, even though I was just beginning to get into school, I started working with him and working with these women, and it just kind of snowballed. And I didn't finish school at that time because there were too many other things going on. But I basically started enjoying and feeling like it's almost like something takes over you and the spirit just enters you and you just do the work. And you just, sometimes I say things even today and it's like, where did that come from? I don't know where it came from. It just came from that river of that wealth of, you know, wisdom and strength and healing that flows through all of us. And that's, you know, there at all times. We just have to tap into it. And so I started helping them, and it's a long story. It's a long path. And, you know, at one point I had to leave school because my ex came back and was threatening me and took my kids and disappeared with them. And I went through a lot of struggles just emotionally to deal with that. And eventually I found myself back in school again. So many different things. I started working with people, and, you know, as my step-grandmother was from Nicaragua, she had family members that were on both sides of the revolution there. You know, they were Sandinistas and also people on, you know, the left that were torturing and doing horrible things. And so when I finally made my way back to school, I reconnected with those forces in Central America, and I started doing things. You know, I was studying and going to Central America, doing work there with women in different organizations and people who were struggling with the war and the horrible things that were going on there. And I kept going back and forth between the two different worlds. And eventually I found psychology. And again, it was, you know, this Puerto Rican, crazy Puerto Rican psychologist, a different one. I don't know why I kept intersecting with these crazy psychologists. And he had a residential treatment program that integrated Santeria and mental health. And he asked me to come and be an intern. And so I went and I started doing work in residential treatment with him, and just seeing the intersection of culture and religion and spirituality, and just the healing, that these healing forces that are seem to be so disparate and so different could be combined into something that really worked and was really powerful. And had, you know, I saw, you know, one particular woman I'll never forget, who was, you know, one of those screaming mentally ill people on the streets, and she wouldn't bathe, and she, you know, would just really lose it and be out of control. And I just saw the power of that, that approach to heal her and to honor her and to, you know, honor what she believed she wanted, you know, that was just very powerful to me. And again, the internship problems always show up, you know, the internship didn't work out, but I ended up staying and working as a counselor in that program for a while. And then, you know, kind of progressed and went on to different programs and different populations. When I finally, many years later, maybe 15 years later, I finally finished school. And when I was getting my doctorate, again, difficulties occurred and I lost my housing and I was homeless. And by that time I had another child, and it was a struggle, but I kept getting hitting these barriers. And so, you know, in the doctoral program, they didn't want to accept my previous studies because they were too old, or they didn't believe that I deserved to be in the program. And I was coming at it with only a bachelor's degree, and they wanted somebody with a master's degree. But when people closed the door in my face and they tried to block me from doing something that I believe in, my anger kicks in, and my anger for me is my go-to emotion. And I just used it as a way to get me to finish school. Because every time they would close the door and I would have self-doubt, the anger would come up and I would say, okay, I'm going to prove to them that they're wrong. Everything that they think about me and all the limitations that they place on me are just going to be that fire again to, you know, forge me into a stronger person, into somebody who can do more. So I always tell people that if I hadn't been an angry person, I would have never made it through graduate school. I would have given up because I remember there was this woman, and there's always been somebody that's been there to kind of lift me up and support me. And there was a woman working in academic support, and I didn't know my times tables when I went back to school. I didn't trust my writing. English is not my first language. I was just, you know, struggling with the whole thing. And I would go to her office and I would cry out of anger and frustration and want to give up. And she would, you know, just pick me up and tell me, okay, you've got all these pieces, let's put them together. And again, you know, finding that unity, finding that intersectionality and making things happen. And I made it, you know, and it's shocking to me even today when people call me doctor, I'm just like, who are they talking about? That doesn't feel like me, but I earned it. It was hard. And, you know, it's allowed me to open doors, not only for myself, but for so many other people.
My goodness. Wow. My mind is resonating on so many levels with what you're talking about. And, you know, it's really hitting home a lot. It's reminding me a lot of, in some aspects, as far as, you know, the mental health and all the tragedies and the challenges, a lot about my own mother. And she struggled for years since I was 7 years old with mental illness. And but she had a heart of gold, and she just needed somebody to be there and give her that break, you know, so help walk her through that. Unfortunately, I wish she would have met you.
Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. It's a blessing to do this work, really, honestly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like yesterday I was working with a couple and they've been really at odds with each other and really in pain. And, you know, I feel the pain and I resonate with that pain. And, you know, I think they say, you know, yesterday they were telling me, oh, you know, we were going through it the other day and we were thinking, okay, what if Doctor, what if, and, you know, I don't like to say my name, but what if, you know, she was here in the room and what would she say and what would she do? And I hear that a lot. It's like, what would she say? You know, mm-hmm. And I feel like it's not me. You know, I'm not an expert. I'm not anybody special. I'm not, you know, I'm just a conduit. I'm just an antenna or, you know, oracle or, you know, things just flow through me. And that's the gift that I have. That's, you know, that I found back way back when. And, you know, that even when I feel, you know, tired or down or, you know, frustrated or just, you know, like I have nothing, it comes through. It just comes. You know, and so I think it's just really a question of figuring out what that is mm-hmm. for you. It could be, you know, you're a good carpenter and you can make wood into something beautiful. Or it could be that, you know, you can grow plants and the plants love you and they thrive. It could be anything. It's just, you know, it's just finding that thing, being open to that thing. And tapping into it. And, you know, it's bigger than us and it's there. You know, I think that this society and this culture, I call it la cultura enfermiza. Mm-hmm. It's a sick culture in a lot of ways that kind of forces us to disregard it or to ignore it or to block it or to, you know, attend to our lives in a mechanical way. That forces us in a particular direction. Mm-hmm. And if we're doing what we're meant to do, it just means surrender. you know, and I feel like I get angry and I realize that the anger is this energy that is harnessed when I surrender, you know. And so usually when I have something in front of me, yesterday I sent a text to Deborah and I said, what did you get me into? What is this? I can't do this. I don't want to do this. I'm not meant to do this. And, you know, and then it's like, okay, well, it's Deborah. And I said I would do it. And I just have to do it. And, you know, it was like, ugh, it's this dread. And every single time I have some new challenge in front of me or some new goal, I go to that place of, you know, flailing around and just going through it. And then I get tired and I surrender and everything falls into place.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I totally understand that process. It feels so familiar to me in my own processing, you know, and the saying that's coming to my mind when you were sharing your story was like, gosh, she's such a force of nature and the hands of creator here on the earth in so many different levels and understanding in so many different levels. You're just so limitless and you're seeing your possibilities and what's possible and then finding, going deep down and trusting your intuition and finding that courage and that fire, adding that fuel to the fire you need to just push through and go forward and then also the ability to surrender. I mean, that's just so hard for so many of us as mujeres. Like, we want everything in place and we want to know what's going to happen next. And I just feel like if all of us can have that gift of being able to go that deep, to find that trust in our intuition, and then the ability to know that we have this awesome team of benevolent beings around us always, wherever we're at, in whatever situation,
yes,
and be able to learn how to surrender that, you know, it just, it's amazing to me. It's amazing to me, but I know it's possible. I love the fact that how you said in the beginning, you know, the phoenixes. I think a lot of us mujeres are the phoenixes and we're trying to, you know, rise above,
yeah,
all of our challenges and situations. And I think it's real important for us to know, you know, it's all our relations to each other, all our relations to nature, all our relations to anyone that Creator puts in our path, to be open, to walk through that door, to see beyond and see limitless possibilities. But I'm wondering, you know, I know for myself, I've said many times, and I was like, I know, Creator, you'll never give me more than I can handle. I know that. I just wish you didn't trust me that much.
Right, exactly.
I was like, you know, this is a hard one. What do you feel that you could share with our audience? Are some of those lessons that you've learned and through your experience that have helped you to be able to do just that, to get to that inner knowing,
yeah,
and that ability to surrender?
Yeah. I don't think we always know. I think that's one of the big things, you know, we wanna know, and we think we know, and we're surrounded by people that know, and, you know, we are. And when we don't know, we're overcome with shame and guilt. And anytime we make decisions on the basis of shame and guilt, they're always the wrong decisions. You know, and I think it's really sitting with the not knowing, you know, that there's, that the Creator is the only one that knows our path, that knows our destiny, that knows where we're going, that knows where we came from. And, you know, we have to trust that every single thing that happens is part of our path. And so, you know, when I get in those places where I'm just like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. I don't like this. It's ugly. It's horrible. I have to go back to, okay, there is a path. It's bigger than me. I don't have any control over it. I can do the best that I can with what I have in front of me. And, you know, something I learned in, you know, recovery programs that I really love is just the serenity prayer. You know, it's like just knowing what you can do something about and what you can't and letting it go, you know, and not having to know, not needing to have answers, you know, and being able to say, you know what, I don't have an answer, but I'll find one. I'll figure it out. You know, it'll come to me. And, you know, just to forgive yourself. You know, I think as women, we're really good at forgiving everybody else, attending to everybody else's needs. I am so good at promoting other people's causes. I'm excellent at it. I'm really good about talking about somebody else or talking about a program or talking about a theory or talking about anything else but myself. And I think, you know, just embracing ourselves and saying, okay, I'm imperfect. I love myself and my imperfectness because my imperfection means that I have room to grow. It means that, you know, I have things to learn. I'm never an expert. I'm never going to be an expert. I'm always being made. I'm always growing. I'm always learning. I'm always, you know, developing. And, you know, I still feel like a little, like that little child that, you know, I don't know what's going to happen next. But at this moment in my life, I know that even in the worst moments, I am protected. I am loved. And if I can see myself through the eyes of the people that love me the most, then I'm going to be okay. You know, I'm going to be okay. I have, you know, I still have fears. I still have, you know, like I said, I don't have the answers. And people will say, oh, you're so wise. And that's so great. It's like, there's wisdom out there. It's just coming through me. It's not mine. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to all of us. And it's just there for us to tap and to get in touch with. Forgive yourself. We make mistakes. We have egos. We, you know, want to control. We get angry. You know, we get frustrated. We're catty. We gossip. You know, we're not perfect. It's not what we've done. It's what do we do now? Now that I know that, I don't want to be this person. You know, at the prison, I work in a prison now. And at the prison, the guys will do some pretty horrible things. They'll say some pretty horrible things. They'll do horrible things to each other. They will come there for really bad reasons. And sometimes they'll come there and my heart is torn because they've been, you know, they're there through an injustice and they're doing time that they don't deserve. And you know, I don't think anybody really deserves it, but, you know, and I have to find a way to connect with them. I have to find the wisdom in them. I have to find, you know, let my ego to the side. And, you know, the thing that I always say, you know, even when somebody's cursing me and maybe they're throwing urine or they're doing whatever they do, you know, I will calmly just tell them, no matter what you do or say, I'm going to treat you with dignity and respect because that's how I want to be treated. But I don't have to tolerate it. I can walk away. You know, and when I see a situation or a person where I feel like it's pulling me out of that place, of that honoring that human that's sitting in front of me, no matter who they are and what they're doing or what they've done, then I have to step back and say, okay, I'm not going to allow that to happen. I have to sit with it. You know, it's, I think one of the things, I don't even remember who said it, but it was something to the effect of, that integrity is really about doing what you know is right, even when nobody's looking. And so that's what I try to do. You know, I'm not always perfect at it. You know, that that little hoodlums comes up from time to time and wants to get away with something or wants to do something wrong or wants to, you know, get over somehow. And I check myself. You know, sometimes I have to check myself afterwards, but I'm getting better at it, better at catching myself. And so, you know, I think there's a limitless world out there if we're open to it, no matter what our circumstances are. You know, if you asked me when I was that little girl, you know, cleaning people's homes at 12 and, you know, these people who thought that, you know, La Muchacha is there for my own pleasure. And, you know, if I thought I would be a doctor today and I would be sitting in this office and I would be doing a podcast, that wasn't even conceivable. Not at all. So whoever's listening, whoever thinks that they're in a place where they can't or that somehow we're special and different, it's mm-hmm. just not the case. It's just open your heart, be faithful, you know, believe that everything has its time. And if we're open to the possibilities, anything can happen.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. And, you know, I have had the pleasure of knowing you for many, many years. And in those years, we've had a lot of adventures. Yes. A lot of adventures. You know, privileged to converse and talk about ideas and share things and create things. And I mean, to me, you're one of the most brilliant people I know. And I'm just blessed to have you as a friend. But I want to share the flip side of you. Not the flip side, but another side of you. Part of my journey and exposure to food, to different foods, and being introduced to the culinary experiences, you have definitely contributed in that way. But I want to talk about some of the things that you like. You know, and I know I wished we could be here, comadre, and be experiencing some of the food that she could make. Okay, because she is an excellent cook, and too bad we can't share food, you know, over the air. But can you share some of the things that you like to do, you know, like travel and food and just art? Because I think the other part is, you know, it's important to balance our life, right? And so we interact, and there's a lot of leaders and mujeres that are caring a lot for their communities. But the importance of balancing that, right? And so would you share with our listeners, you know, some of those fun things that you incorporate into your life?
Well, one of the biggest things, I love cooking for people. I love Yes. nurturing people. I love attending to people. And I love culture, just any culture, you know, so it's, if I see something that I like and I'm a very adventurous eater, I will try to find a way to cook it. So now at this moment, I think I know how to do some Thai food, Chinese food, Puerto Rican food, Salvadorian food, Mexican food, some Russian food. I just like to try different things and try to learn how to cook them for people and surprise them with different things. So when you know, I've had the opportunity to work at different agencies where there are a lot of different cultures. And usually what I do when I'm doing trainings or I'm doing meetings is I will always cook for everybody. I love dancing. And unfortunately, the pandemic has really wrecked my dancing opportunities. But I've found a way to dance in my house. So dancing is something that I love to do. And if you can combine dancing and food, we used to have our graduations and we would have dancing and food. And it's an amazing thing to bring people together. I also love traveling. This coming week, I am going to meet my family in the East Coast. And we're going to go drive to South Carolina to have Thanksgiving and Indigenous Peoples Day and cook. And then I go back to DC and I'm going to fly out to Poland. And not because I ever had an idea of going to Poland, but just because the places that I thought about going to are on lockdown. And so I just told myself, okay, the next ticket that comes up that's relatively reasonable, I'm just going to go there. And it ended up being Gdansk, Poland. So I have no idea what's going to happen there, because usually the way I travel is, you know, people think I'm crazy and it's hard to travel with me because I'm very spontaneous. I have a place to stay for 3 days. I'm going to be gone for 3 weeks, and I just get there, scope it out, try to figure out what people are doing and what's interesting, and do whatever it is. And if I don't like it, then I'll just go somewhere else. And I don't know where I'm going. And I think I told Deborah this. One time I was taking a trip, and I was in Spain, and I was on a train from Sevilla to Barcelona. And I met this woman who was reading a book about a treatment technique, a psychological treatment technique that is very rare and is only done in certain areas in the world. And I saw her reading it, and I said, wow, what's that? And she started talking to me, and we started talking about being somewhat older women and who travel alone. And, you know, what we like to do, I like to stay in youth hostels. So I'm like always the oldest person there because there's stuff happening and you hear about everything that's happening. And so she told me about a youth hostel in Lisbon in Portugal. And while I wasn't going to Portugal, the universe just blocked my way to Bilbao, which was the place I was going to go. I couldn't get tickets and I couldn't get a training. And so I was like, okay, I'm going to Lisbon. And when I got to Lisbon, I met a German woman who was traveling she was in the youth hostel. And we got on a bus to go to this castle. And it was the wrong bus. And the guy wouldn't tell us that it was the wrong bus. And the people on the bus were like, but you're going in the wrong direction. And we were like, okay. We looked at each other and we said, okay, well, we'll see something we wouldn't have normally seen, because who knows where we're going? And that just, you know, that's how I travel. So we'll see what happens. I have no idea what I'm going to do in Poland, of all places. It's the last place I wouldn't even think of going there.
So about how many continents have you hit? How many places?
Continents, I don't know, but I think I've been to 39 countries.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and people say, you know, when I tell people, you should travel, it's amazing. You meet all these people. And I find my tribe everywhere I go, which is crazy. No matter where I go, I find my tribe, you know. And so, and they say, well, we don't have money to travel. Well, I've never had money to travel. You know, I just decide that's what I'm going to do. And, you know, and I, the first time I ever traveled without my family, I just decided that back in the day, they used to have standbys. So I signed up for 5 standbys, and I told myself I'm going to go on the next standby comes up. And it was a standby to Germany. And like I said, I wasn't thinking of going to Germany, but I ended up going to Germany. And the particular place that I was at was not great. I think they thought I was Turkish, and they didn't want me there, and they yelled at me in German everywhere I went. And so I just decided, well, this is not the place for me to go, and I'm going to get on the train and go somewhere else. And I ended up in Paris, and I didn't speak French, and I slept in a playground. And I met a bunch. By the time I woke up in the morning, people saw me sleeping in the playground with my Mexican sarape to keep myself warm. And I woke up and there were all these bodies next to me. And I was like, oh, wow. So we decided to go get breakfast. You know, we went and got a croissant and some coffee, and they were going to somewhere else. And it was like, okay, well, let's go.
I think the amazing thing is then you get all those experiences and then bring it back and you apply it in the work that you do. Because I have witnessed that and been part of that. And I think that's the amazing part of the healing, right? Bringing those experiences and those exposures and somehow integrating it into the work that we do.
Yeah. Because there's so much wisdom and beauty everywhere, whether I'm sitting you know, with people who live in the dump in San Salvador, or, you know, I'm on the train with these. And it's funny because I was talking to my clients the other day, and I was saying, they were like, oh, you're going, and what are you going to do? Who are you going to stay? I don't know. You know, and it's funny that everywhere I go, somebody adopts me. So it's like these women on the train, oh, you can't sit by yourself. You need to come and eat with us. And, you know, they take me home. Or I go to Airbnb in Johannesburg, and, you know, these guys, you know, decide that they just like having me around, and you should just stay, and you don't have to pay, just stay here, you know. And Colombia, and this tower that I was staying at, in this weird tower on top of a hill. And, you know, it's like, why don't you just stay a few more days? And, you know, you don't have to pay, just stay here. And I don't know how that happens. I have no idea how that happens, you know, and it's weird. You know, I bump into people that there's some, you know, they say the 7 degrees of separation, there's some connection, you know, there's some crazy connection. So I'm sitting in this little village in Mexico singing Cuban Revolution songs and, you know, talking about Che Guevara, or, you know, it's just crazy. It just happens. It's like you connect with, again, it's that universal, you know, flow of connectedness that we have. And, you know, and if you're open, other people who are open will feel it, and they'll be there, you know, and people will show up that can help you in some way, shape, or form. You know, I had this wonderful friend who was, you know, she was like 85-year-old Polish immigrant woman that, you know, she was just this amazing friend to me. And we were friends. We met in Cuba on a work brigade, and we stayed friends until she passed. And she was like 40 years older than me, you know, and she helped me get my, even though she didn't believe in psychology, she helped me pass my licensing exam. She would sit with me and we would drink wine and eat cheese and crackers, which was her thing. And she would help me study. And every so often she would help me do these practice tests. And she'd ask me, do you really believe this crap? And I'm like, yeah, she didn't believe in anything that she was helping me with. And she didn't believe in psychologists, but because it was me and because we had this connection and it was important to me, she was willing to sit at her kitchen table and help me do this day after day after day until I passed.
Wow. So many aha moments in that conversation right now. What the thing that sticks out to me the most is your radical trust, and that of knowing, like, wherever I'm supposed to be, that's where I'm going to be, and that's going to be good. And it seems like it always manifests that way. I mean, imagining this celestial travel planner that just hovers over you and just guides you to the next thing. And the fact that you're willing, I mean, all of us could have that inspiration, I think, but because we don't trust it, and because of our fear and maybe our past or whatever, we block those experiences. I think it's beautiful that you're trusting wherever you're supposed to be is perfect. Like Maestro Deb says all the time, everything's perfect, perfect timing. And for you to be able to follow that guidance. Maestro Deb had mentioned something earlier, and it just inspired in me a question. He said, all these places that you've been, you've learned so many things, and you learned songs, and you learned tradition, and you learned culture, you learned food, you learned all of these different things from all, you know, around the world. What a priceless experience. But I'm just wondering if there's maybe, you know, 3 or 4 core teachings, you know, especially in working with your clients, and as you mentioned, with your clients in the prisons, where you probably are the light at the end of the tunnel for them, even if it's for the moments they get to be in your presence. I'm sure you're just a powerful force of light and hope and inspiration for all those that you work with. But is there maybe like like three or four core teachings that you feel in doing the work that you do are very important for us to remember as we do the work that we do, that would be helpful for all of those that are listening, you know, even in their personal relationships. But I feel like you have, like, I'm just waiting for, do you have a book out or is there going to be one? I want that copy.
I know everybody tells me that. We've been talking about possibly doing a game or an app where these different crazy things that I do with people could be represented and where people can take their own guided tour through that process. Because, you know, people have repeatedly told me that I need to write a book, and I like writing, but I can't see. People don't read books anymore. And I feel like I need to get up with the technology. So I am.
Audiobook?
Yeah, we're looking to do that. And now I'm doing a podcast. What the heck?
Yeah.
So maybe I think I do need to do something. I need to listen. That's one of the things that I haven't been listening to and acting on. And so I need to do that. I think, you know, I'm trying to think of. It's always comes from some inspiration in the moment or whatever. I think one of the things that I harp on when I'm doing trainings is just looking at people through the lens of biopsychosocial, spiritual, that we live in all of those areas and we tend to be stuck in one or the other. The guys who are in the prison tend to be stuck in the environment. And you know, and they don't realize that our environment is not just physical. Our environment is within us. It's spiritual and it's emotional and it's psychological. And what I tell them all the time is, you know, kind of walk through this with them. And I think what Deb was mentioning earlier is just finding balance, no matter where you are, no matter how bad and extreme these circumstances are, is that your body can be, you know, here in not a good situation, but your mind can be anywhere you want it to be, anywhere you want it to be. And so one of the things that I do with the inmates and, you know, that I learned when I was very young and when I was locked up was that lesson that your body is here, but your mind can be anywhere you want it to be. And it can be with anybody you want it to be. You know, living or dead. It can be with anybody, you know, that you know or don't know. Because we are part of that, you know, that celestial or that spiritual connection. And so, you know, what I do, what I practice with them a lot of times is taking a mental vacation. If you can't physically leave, if you can't get on a plane, if you can't get on a bus, if you can't, you know, physically leave the environment, your mind can go. You can go somewhere in your mind. And you need that. We all need a vacation. We all need a break from our situation at times. And so one of the things that I, even, you know, when I'm sitting at my desk and I'm overwhelmed and frustrated, I will take a little vacation. I'll go somewhere. You know, if you have the opportunity and you're not in, you know, scarcity mode, having things around you that remind you of the world outside. You know, for the longest time, I had a picture of this little boy that looked just like my grandson dancing in the rain on my desktop. And, you know, and it just remind me, you know, of that just innocence and that beauty, and just dance is such a wonderful gift. You know, I just love dancing. And so I could look and focus at that picture and just imagine myself in the rain dancing. You know, I don't use an umbrella ever.
Yeah.
I love being out in the rain, no matter how horrible it is. And, you know, just imagining myself being in the rain dancing. And I don't know what it is for you or what it is for anybody who's listening, but just reminding yourself that your body is here, but your mind can be anywhere you want it to be. And take that trip. We need that trip from time to time, you know. I think that's one of the things, you know, something that I'm not as good at is that, you know, our bodies are a gift that's been given to us to get us through this passage and to really take care of our bodies, you know, pay attention. One of the things that I do with my clients a lot of times is to say, okay, when she was saying that, you know, when that was happening, where did you feel it? Where was it? What was happening in you, in your body? How does that show up when you're feeling depressed, when you're feeling angry, when you're feeling sad, when you're in an argument, when you're, you know, when you're being harmed in some way, you know, how does that show up? You know, we learn that trauma is carried in our bodies. Our bodies tell the story. And so looking and seeing, you know, what's happening in our bodies, where do we hold our pain? Where do we hold our shame? Where do we hold our sadness? And attending to that and saying, okay, when I feel that, I have something to do. I acknowledge it. I honor it. It's something that's happening to tell me something needs to be fixed. You know, when we think about people with diabetes, the problem with that is when people get neuropathy, they can't feel when they injure themselves. So they end up getting these injuries that don't heal. You know, we need to learn to know when we're being injured. You know, we need to pinpoint it, say, where is it in our bodies? How does it show up around us? How do we behave? You know, because I don't think we always make the connection between our heart and our mind and, you know, our environment. You know, any one of those things, an adjustment in any of those areas can affect the way that we deal with our hurt, you know, and healing needs to come in all of those realms. It can't just be in one realm. It has to come in all of those realms. So when we're looking at, when I do a treatment plan with somebody, I'm looking at those areas and incorporating those areas. You know, I'm going to be on vacation, so I'm not going to be seeing my patients. And I gave them homework. And one of the homeworks that I gave them was an art project. Mm-hmm. When I work with somebody and I'm, you know, I feel like it's a meeting of the minds. It's a meeting of the heart. It's a meeting of the spirit. And when we end that relationship, it doesn't stop. It's still there. I carry a piece of them in me, and they carry a piece of me in them. And so, you know, I do a little ritual with them at the end of therapy. There's this children's book that I love that's called The Invisible String. And I will sit with them and we'll make a string that reminds them of the connection that they have with me. And that I have with them.
Yeah.
And they take it with them when they leave. And so I think the physical manifestation of that value, that relationship is really important. Just like, you know, we do altars. Los altares are there not only to create a vehicle for the connection, but it's also to remind us that we were loved and that we loved. And, you know, that those people are still present with us. And so we need to, you know, we need to connect with that little child, you know, and a lot of times I'll use children's books with adults, you know, just to remind us that we're still those little children. I'm still that little girl that was berated by my grandfather, that nothing I ever did was good enough, that was abusive, and I recreate that circumstance in my relationships, not to the same extent that I did, you know, early on in my life, but it's still there. I'm still working on that. I'm a work in progress. You know, I haven't mastered romantic relationships yet. I'm still working on that part. You know, that's my challenge right now. But, you know, it's, we're all kind of needing to remind ourselves of where we came from. My son's girlfriend is pregnant right now. And I keep telling him, you need to take a picture of that panza. Yeah. You know, you need to remind yourself, because there's going to come a time when you forget.
Yes.
You forget what that process was, you know.
Right.
And so it's important for us to go back and remind ourselves, you know, and have representations of those important passages in our life. And so, you know, sometimes we don't have that. I don't have, you know, pictures from my early childhood. I don't, you know, and I don't like taking pictures, but there are other things that I have around me that remind me of that passage. And, you know, it's just as important to look back as it is to look forward. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think one of the sicknesses of this culture, of this, you know, this country, is that we're ahistorical. You can go to any country in the world and people know their history. They know ancient history. This is, you know, one of the few places in the world that I've been where people don't know their history. They don't know their recent history. Mm-hmm. This, all this stuff that's going on in this country right now, we just don't remember what happened in January.
Right.
You know? Right. We don't remember. We don't remember what people said yesterday. You know, it's like we have to hold ourselves accountable, but we also have to invest in history. That there are lessons that we learn, you know, there's lessons that we can apply to today, you know, and so I think learning from other people's history is just as important. Mm-hmm. You know, when I travel, I try to travel like somebody who lives in that country. I try to experience it the way somebody who lives there experiences it. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not into the tourism thing or, you know, I'll go on a tour occasionally just to get the history. But for the most part, I try to experience what it is to be a person in that country. And so, you know, I think exposing us ourselves to as many different peoples as possible is really important too.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yes. Well, I tell you, yeah, when we have these, I know, because we could keep on going, you know,
I know. I want ending, her history book.
It goes so quick when we're having such a great conversation. But, you know, we've run out of time, unfortunately. But before we end, we always end with a consejo. This podcast is about healing generations. And so, doctora, can you leave us with a consejo?
The thing that comes to me right now is just, again, it's about love. Mm-hmm. You know, it's about knowing that every single person on this planet, no matter what they've been through, no matter the abuse, no matter what, somebody loved them. Mm-hmm. Somebody has loved them and somebody has loved us. No matter what we've done, no matter where we've been, we just need to connect with that love. You know,
beautiful.
Love yourself. Remember that the people that are in front of you, no matter what they're doing, no matter how they're behaving, they were loved by someone. And if we can help them connect with that, that's the biggest gift that you can give.
Mm, beautiful.
You know, that's what we need in this country right now. We need more love.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you. Thank you on behalf of the National School Mothers Network. And I want to thank all our listeners out there. Thank you for spending this time. I know, and it was my word, that this would not be a disappointment. And I know that you have enjoyed this hour with us, and you're taking many gifts away. And there's been words here that you heard today where you're like, wow, that's what I needed to hear. And so thank you. Thank you for spending time with us today. And we really wish you bendiciones as you continue on this journey, because this is a journey for life. And so as you go on to remember what you hear and most of all, to be able to implement it, practice it in your life, because it's a lifelong journey. So with that, we're going to sign off today. And so this is Maestra Deborah Camarillo over here in the Bay saying bendiciones. And this is
Maestra Susana Armijo, so humble. So honored with you, Dr. Mosqueda, today. I'm going to take these lessons and be processing them and really trying to live these teachings for many generations to come. I feel in Laket, you are my other me in so many ways. I just resonated with everything that you shared. And I just want you to know that I'm so honored. I can't wait to meet you in person. And you are love.
Thank you.
You are love. Adelante. God bless you.
Love you.
And thank you, Doc. Thank you for blessing us with your presence. And I know you hate to do this, but thank you for doing it with us today. So with that,
thank you for having me.
Bendiciones.
Blessings. Love you.
Bendiciones. Adelante.
For more information about Healing Generations and the Healing Generations Institute, visit nationalcompadresnetwork.org and be sure to subscribe to stay up to date with our new releases.